cause it to go in a certain direction. Sheep aren't like that. Sheep need to be led. So when the psalmist uses the image of a shepherd for the Lord, he's saying that God leads us rather than forces us. We never have to worry about God leading us anywhere that will cause us harm. With God as our shepherd, we can drink deeply of living water and be nourished for life's journey, no matter where that journey takes us.
Wonderful, Renee.
Who left his throne above.
Old Testament reading is from Isaiah 49, 8 through 16. This is what the Lord says, "In the time of my favor, I will answer you, and in the day of salvation, I will help you. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people, to restore the land and to reassign its desolate inheritance, to say to the captives, come out, and to those in darkness, be free. They will feed beside the roads and find pasture on every barren hill. They will neither hunger nor thirst, nor will the desert heat or the sun beat down upon them. He who has compassion on them will guide them and lead them beside the springs of water. I will turn all my mountains into roads, and my highways will be raised up. See, they will come from afar, some from the north, some from the west, some from the region of Aswan. Shout for joy, you heavens. Rejoice, you earth. Burst into song, you mountains, for the Lord comforts the people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. The Lord has forgotten me. Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has borne? Though she may forget, I will not forget you. See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are ever before me." Yeah. And may you please stand if you're able for the reading of the gospel. And it's John 4, 1 through 30 and 39 through 42. Jesus said to the Samaritan woman, "The Pharisees heard that Jesus was winning and baptizing more disciples than John. Actually, Jesus himself did not baptize anyone, only his disciples did. So when Jesus heard what was being said, he left Judea and went back to Galilee. On his way there, he had to go through Samaria. In Samaria, he came to a town named Sychar, which was not far from the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by the trip, sat down by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came in to draw some water, and Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink of water, please.' His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The woman said, 'You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan, so how can you ask me for a drink? Jews will not use the same cups and bowls that Samaritans use.' Jesus answered, 'If you only knew what God gives and who it is that is asking you for a drink, you would ask him, and he would give you life-giving water.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'you don't have a bucket, and the well is deep. Where would you get that life-giving water? It was our ancestor Jacob who gave us this well. He and his sons and his flocks all drank from it. You don't claim to be greater than Jacob, do you?' Jesus answered, 'Whoever drinks this water will get thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water that I will give him will never ever thirst once more. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring, which will provide him with life-giving water and give him eternal life.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'give me that water, that I will never be thirsty again, nor will I have to come here to draw water.' 'Go and call your husband,' Jesus told her, 'and come back.' 'I don't have a husband,' she answered. Jesus replied, 'You are right when you say you don't have a husband. You have been married to 5 men, and the man you live with now is not really your husband. You have told me the truth.' 'I see you are a prophet, sir,' the woman said. 'My Samaritan ancestors worshiped God on this mountain, but you Jews say that Jerusalem is the place where we should worship God.' Jesus said to her, 'Believe me, woman, the time will come when people will not worship the Father either on the mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans do not really know whom you worship, but we Jews know whom we worship, because it is from the Jews that salvation comes. But the time is coming, and is already here, when by the power of God's Spirit, people who worship the Father as he really is offering him the true worship that he wants. God is Spirit, and only the power of the Spirit can people worship him as he really is? The woman said to him, I know that the Messiah will come, and when he comes, he will tell us everything. Jesus answered, I am he, I who am telling, talking to you right now. At that moment, Jesus' disciples returned, and they were greatly surprised to find him talking with a woman. But none of them said this to her, what do you want? Or asked him, why are you talking with her? Then the woman left her water jar, went back to the town, and said to the people there, come and see the man who told me everything I have ever done. Could he be the Messiah? So they left the town and went to Jesus. Now we have, let's see, verses 39 through 42. Many of the Samaritans in that town believed in Jesus because the woman had said, he told me everything I had ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they begged him to stay with them, and Jesus stayed there 2 days. Many who believed because of his message, and they told the woman, we believe now, not because of what you said, but because we ourselves have heard him, and we know that he really is the Savior of the world. And all who believe, please say amen.
Amen. Amen.
And you may be seated. And now we'll be having the opening hymn, He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought, and it's up here for 128 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
Please be comfortable. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Last Sunday night, Scott found a movie for us to watch that made my heart truly sing. Now, do you want to guess what type of movie I like? Action? Rom-com? Superheroes? Any of that you want to guess?
Superheroes.
I think superheroes, I do like those a lot. But it wasn't any of those. It was Peanuts, the movie. I was so excited. I love Peanuts, the movie. Now, we didn't watch it all, but a few minutes of watching Peanuts, what a treat that was. Who doesn't love Snoopy and Woodstock? And of course, Charlie Brown and his friends, right? I especially love Charlie Brown. Oh, don't we all? He tries so hard. He always feels so inadequate. And he's often told he's a... Do you remember what he's called? A blockhead, right? Yeah. And he's so trusting. Sometimes trusting to the point of having the football pulled away from him when he kicks. So up he goes flying and lands flat on his back. Charlie Brown is an unlikely hero. What makes him so beloved is his beautiful heart, that and his honesty. Now this wasn't in the movie, but one of my favorite Peanuts scenes of all time is when Charlie Brown goes to seek help from his neighborhood 5-cent bargain psychiatrist, Lucy. He sees her sign up in her little handmade place there, little shack, and he puts his nickel in her can, hopeful that she can help him as he struggles with feeling down and depressed while the rest of the world is happy and enjoying the Christmas season. Well, Lucy goes over, dusts off all the snow from her stand, and sits down to listen, and good old Chuck says what sums up, I think, is the human condition. Charlie Brown looks at Lucy, the psychiatrist, and says, I'm in sad shape. Isn't that the human condition, right? Truer words were never spoken. Aren't we all in sad shape? Charlie Brown is just the only one brave enough and honest enough to verbalize it. Now, Lucy, in an attempt to get to the root